Heaven sent.
Growing up in the 90s, I have personally seen and experienced some of the most groundbreaking advances in gaming technology. Starting with the original PlayStation at the tender age of 5 years old, I was already indulging in the likes of many classics such as Metal Gear Solid, Pandemonium, and a personal favorite of mine, Wild 9. And although the PS1 was obviously a huge step up from its gaming predecessors, nothing could compare to the sheer amount of power that was being brought to the table with the early 2000s modern consoles. The Sony PlayStation 2, Xbox Original, and Nintendo GameCube all stepped onto the scene, quickly changing the standards of graphics capabilities and basically the way the games played as a whole. Video games were becoming more ambitious than ever before, and in this video, we're going to be covering some of the titles that paved the way for a lot of the games that we play in present day, and also a couple that were a little too big for their britches.
Hey look, I think that's a nipple!
So without further ado, let's hop in the time machine and get this show rocking.
This party's getting crazy. Let's rock.
The early 2000s were a great time for not only movies and video games, but also a golden era for music. Hip-hop was reinventing itself, replacing the 90s boom-bap sound with something much more energetic and aggressive. This brought upon a slew of charismatic artists to flood the charts, and most of which were some pretty intimidating dudes. So what better way to celebrate this energy and aggression than to put all these dope artists together in one game? And let them rough each other up a bit. Well, EA Games did just that. Starting with the 2003 release of Def Jam Vendetta, we were met with a sequel that single-handedly changed the way fighting games were played. That sequel being Def Jam Fight for NY. Released on September 1st, 2004, Fight for NY was easily the most ambitious of its genre, combining fluid fighting mechanics, a crowd full of screaming heavily armed bystanders, and a playlist of hard-hitting early 2000s rap songs. Fight for NY was truly an experience that's hard to replicate, but what made it so different from other fighting games was its wide array of tactics you could choose to handle each battle. Your arena will usually be filled with bottles and other objects that can be smashed into the face of your opponent. Speakers, windows, and even your homie's brand new Escalade can be used to crush the opposition. Heavy punches, submissions, and slams are all surefire ways to end the fight, but nothing quite satisfies like finishing your opponent off with a blazing move. The Blazin' system brings upon a special attack that is rewarded with good performance in a fight. Land all of your punches, slams, and throw in a couple of taunts, you'll be breakdancing on Exhibit's head before you know it.
This will break some bones! See? You know what to do!
You ain't looking so good, homie!
And the story mode plays in a very satisfying manner as well. Taking place after the events of Def Jam Vendetta, the earlier antagonist of the series, D-Mob, is arrested by two NYPD cops by the names of Jervis and Starks. While en route to the station, the police vehicle is struck by an SUV, causing it to flip and incapacitate the officers. D-Mob crawls his way from the wreckage and gets in the SUV of the assailant and drives away. But not without one of the officers first catching a glimpse of the vehicle's driver.
So there's a madman on the loose, crashing cars and kidnapping grown men, it seems. Who could it be? Well, it's you. It's you, actually.
And so begins the creation of our character, which is done by describing the said suspect's appearance. At first, it's not the most incredible character creator, but the customization really begins to flesh out once you begin to acquire some cash through the many underground fights you'll be signing up for. From jewels to clothes and tattoos to hairstyle, everything is customizable, and to a pretty deep degree. I constantly found myself going back to my boy Snowman for a new fit before the next fight, and having tons of fun switching out old chains for a new shinier version. But the customization does not stop there. You can also hit the gym and add experience points to your character. Not only can you grow the overall strength and toughness through the gym, but you can also learn new blazing moves, with the capability of having up to 4 different moves assigned at once. And if you're looking to broaden your horizons in terms of fighting style, they've got you covered on that as well. Allowing up to 3 overall fighting styles that can be applied to your character, which in turn brings out a pretty cool sense of progression. I had a lot of fun with multiple playthroughs and trying different style combinations. It really brings a sense of replayability to the game and keeps it from running too stale, in a genre that can usually run in a pretty linear direction. To this day, Def Jam Fight for NY is easily one of the most ambitious and original fighting games of all time. With an expansive moveset, 67 different playable characters, and a fluid fighting system that's easy to pick up and learn, it's a no-brainer that Fight for NY was ahead of its time and remains to be a classic to this day. If you somehow missed the opportunity to give this game a chance, I highly recommend you do so as soon as possible. You'll be glued to your screen for decades to come. Take it from someone who's been playing it since grade school.
I'm gonna take your tongue out and lick my ass with it.
Stand by, 1010, investigate a reported disturbance at Acer Plaza.
10-4 dispatcher, verify address.
They were all dead. The final gunshot was an exclamation mark to everything that had led to this point. I released my finger from the trigger. And then it was over.
Very few titles, even in our present day, can go toe-to-toe with the cinematic masterpiece that is Max Payne. Max Payne tells the story of a former NYPD officer who's left with nothing to lose after having both his wife and newborn child murdered in a home invasion gone wrong. Max is on a mission to exact revenge on those who killed his family, but in the midst of his search, he's only drugged deeper into a rabbit hole after being framed for the murder of his former police partner, Alex Balder.
There was nothing I could do. He was dead. I could tell by the empty, accusing stare of his eyes.
It's an ugly plot, and this game has no problem with visualizing how seedy and cutthroat the underworld of New York City can be. Each level is carefully crafted and really leaves you with a disgusted feel as you shoot your way through dim-lit corridors and smoke-infested mob hideouts. And not only is the game design aesthetically pleasing, but to say this game was well-written would be a complete understatement. Each section of Max Payne is beautifully narrated by the voice of James McCaffrey. And to this day, I've yet to find a piece of media that can put words together as poetically as Max does.
Outside, the mercury was falling fast. It was colder than the devil's heart, raining ice pitchforks as if the heavens were ready to fall. Everyone was running for shelter like there was no tomorrow. It didn't get any better when I got to the subway.
But what made Max Payne such an ambitious title was its use of the bullet time mechanic. Bullet time was a feature that made slow motion gameplay a reality. For the first time in gaming history, a whole new level of style was brought into the world of third-person shooters. When bullet time is activated, time slows down, allowing Max to dodge, shoot, and roll his way through hordes of enemies with ease. I remember seeing this mechanic in action for the first time as a kid, and man was it incredible. Each bullet that's shot can be seen with detailed accuracy, following with a 360-degree camera angle, giving us a view of the sheer carnage done to the last enemy in your current vicinity. It really felt like you were playing out the iconic bullet time scene in The Matrix every time you cleared a room of angry foes. And given the time frame of how close The Matrix and Max Payne were released from one another, you would think they had drawn their influence from that very same movie. But on the contrary, their main influence for introducing such an ambitious mechanic actually came from the many action films of director John Woo. They even paid homage to his inspiration with this scene right here.
Quick!
Not so fast. The password. John Woo.
Come on. Okay, John Woo.
All right. Come right in.
John Woo was well known for his use of slow-mo in his films, and the team at Remedy Entertainment, i.e. the creators of Max Payne, saw this mechanic as a resource for their players to be able to take on insane amounts of enemies. Remedy even crafted their own engine to ensure that their game ran these ideas as smooth as possible. And given the praise that Max Payne received, I think it's safe to say they did an amazing job. And to say that their ideas were an inspiration to a lot of other game developers, well, that would also be an understatement. The success of bullet time and slow-mo action in gaming became quite the trend for some time, spawning titles such as True Crime Streets of LA, Dead to Rights, Fear, and also a game presented by Mr. John Woo himself, Stranglehold. And although other games may have improved the mechanics of Max Payne over time, we have to give credit where it's due and give Remedy the flowers they deserve for crafting such an incredible series with gameplay that stands the test of time. Max Payne is personally one of my favorite series in gaming, and you would be doing yourself a disservice to miss out on such a tragic but beautifully written story. I think we all got a little bit of Max inside of us, a flawed but loving human who will do anything to make right of the wrongs in their life.
Relax, Max. You're a nice guy. I don't kill nice guys.
You're not bad yourself.
even if it means blowing 1,000 rounds of ammo and starting a serious painkiller addiction, well, maybe I retract my previous statement. Now let's get prepared to switch gears as we step into the wacky and off-color world of BMX XXX. A game that tried its very best to be an ambitious funhouse, but only ended up taking a set of handlebars to the nuts. This game came to us in an era that spawned many extreme sports titles, such as the Tony Hawk series, SSX Tricky, and Dave Mirra's BMX. Also, on a side note, this game was actually supposed to be a Dave Mirra title, but Mirra and many other professionals that were supposed to appear in the game backed out once they realized the negative backlash this game's content could cause for their careers and sponsorships. Yikes. This event caused the game's title to be changed from Dave Mirra's BMX XXX to just BMX XXX. And a claim was even sued by Mirra for $20 million after he claimed he had no idea they were going to take this game in the direction they did. And that's only the beginning for the list of problems this game had in development and execution.
Damn it! I can't get it up! You know what I mean!
But that's neither here nor there, because we're here to talk about how the game plays and why we had to include it on this list. You see, around this time, some of the best ways to gain notoriety and fill your pockets with sweet coin was to have the media paint you as the devil and have the whole world try to protest your existence. Talk about building a buzz. I mean, the early 2000s had their fair share of rappers and rockers alike, stirring up the pots of angry mothers everywhere. But this didn't stop with just music. Oh no. At this time, Grand Theft Auto 3 was under heavy fire due to its copious amounts of violence, graphic language, and what many deemed as a glorification to a criminal lifestyle.
Hey, I'm bored. When you gonna drill me?
In a moment, sweetheart. I got a little business to take care of.
But part of what made these artists, games, and movies so popular was the insane amounts of bad publicity around them. And what's more intriguing to a person than diving into what they see as forbidden?
Are you sure about that?
Well, as a young lad myself, I remember tricking my mom into renting BMX XXX. And it wasn't because I wanted to ride bikes, I'll tell you that much. Looking back on it, I could vaguely recall anything about the game, other than it was a janky mess. And so, I decided to fire up the uncensored GameCube version for this video right here. And well, it went something like this.
Oh my gosh, dude.
So this game is pretty much the equivalent of a wet fart. It tried too hard to be edgy and different, and only ended up shitting itself in the process.
Fucking thing sucks!
Not only was the gameplay infuriating, but the campaign slash challenge whatever mode was literally just a laughable mess. And look, I get it, there's not much room for a deep story when it comes to extreme sports titles, but this game is just all over the place. And while I found the old school offensive South Park type humor to be pretty entertaining at first, it quickly overstayed its welcome and just started getting on my nerves. And the game wasn't really ambitious in its gameplay mechanics or anything like that. It was just ambitious in the sense that Acclaim refused to give up on it, and it was still released. And you would think that after having the star of your game drop out, multiple curveballs in the development process, and both Walmart and Toys R Us banning the sale of your game in their stores, that they would have just thrown in the towel, and I wouldn't be sitting here talking about this fever dream of a game, but here we are. And although it fell flat on its face, BMX XXX does have a satisfying nostalgia to it. In the couple of hours I had spent playing it, it felt like I was transported back to a much simpler time, back when Pizza Hut still tasted good and games came with plenty of content to unlock. And with content like this, who isn't gonna get straight to work? All in all, the game sucked. But it was a risk Acclaim was willing to take, albeit they almost lost everything because of it. But you gotta salute their dedication, at the very least. Oh, and the soundtrack was chock full of bangers, so kudos for that.
Why are these people? What are they planning? Chainsaw.
son of a gun!
Son of a...
On January 11, 2005, a legend was born. And in a list of ambitious games of the early 2000s era, I'd be absolutely insane to not include one of the most innovative and critically acclaimed titles of all time, that being Resident Evil 4. The Resident Evil series dates all the way back to the late 90s, and is also credited with being the creator of the survival horror genre. With its use of tank controls, item management, and a sense of danger at every corner, Resident Evil was an experience unlike anything people had ever seen before in gaming history. The series did incredibly well on a global scale, with its first three games selling over 13 million copies worldwide. But over time, the same recycled RE formula started to lose its appeal with the team at Capcom. And with the new wave of next-gen consoles hitting the scene in the early 2000s, Capcom knew they were going to have to come correct with a strong sequel. The original model of RE4, which is now referred to as Resident Evil 3.5, was set to be more of a paranormal tale, straying away from the typical zombie fanfare that was seen in previous games. The project boasted some stunning visuals for its time, as well as some enhanced camera work, moving from the basic fixed camera angles to a more dynamic approach. And it should be noted that this was also used for the spin-off game, Resident Evil Code Veronica. But before we get me on a fanboy rant about my favorite series in gaming, let's talk more on the development and achievements of the final product of Resident Evil 4. Long story short, Capcom scrapped the paranormal ghost tale that was RE3.5 for a much bolder storyline. One that would bring our protagonist Leon Scott Kennedy on a mission to save the president's daughter, Ashley Graham. Now, it's not the most ambitious of storylines, but what was truly remarkable about Resident Evil 4 was its use of the over-the-shoulder camera angle. You see, before RE4 came barreling through the shelves of GameStops across the world, we were left in despair to janky control schemes when it came to how third-person shooters were played. But everything changed once this new perspective was introduced. The over-the-shoulder view made controlling your character much more immersive, and also provided a fun challenge for fans of the shooter genre. And due to your character having to be at a standstill when aiming down the sights, it made for a suspenseful gaming experience that was unlike anything we had ever seen before. And if you're too young to remember when this game was first released, you probably think I'm crazy to be talking up such a common mechanic in today's gaming. But I remember playing RE4 for the first time on the GameCube as a kid. Talk about being blown away. This new perspective was so groundbreaking that it completely changed the way that games were developed for good, inspiring some of the biggest IPs in gaming, such as Gears of War, Grand Theft Auto, and the Uncharted series. RE4 also made use of many QTEs, or quick time events, in their cutscenes. Albeit, they may not have pioneered this mechanic, but RE4 was among one of the first titles to begin using these to immerse their players and keep them on their toes. Pair this with a solid shooting mechanic, sexy hair, and some presidential ballistics, you've got yourself one hell of a game.
Oh, you pervert!
RE4 is critically acclaimed as one of the best video games of all time, and rightfully so. If you're a gamer born anytime before 2005, I'm assuming you already know what I'm talking about. But if not, I highly recommend you get yourself a copy as soon as possible. Oh, one more thing. If you're trying to decide on whether to get the original or the 2023 remake, it's easy. Just get both. I knew that talking about video games could be so much work, but you know what, I had a good time, I hope you guys did too. If y'all want a part 2 of this video, drop a comment down below, suggest a couple of games I could put in the next list, I'll make it happen for you. But until next time, my name is Vincent, hope y'all have a blessed day, and hope to see you in the next video. Peace.